Hi, my name is Nathan Buckey, and I work under Professor Mark Mueller in the UC Berkeley High Performance Robotics Lab. Today I'm going to be discussing rectangular pyramid partitioning using integrated depth sensors, also known as the RAPPIDS algorithm, which is a fast planner for multicopter navigation. In this work, we're concerned with solving the classic collision avoidance problem. That is, we want to find a path through the environment that will not result in our vehicle colliding with obstacles. More specifically, our goal is to find these collision-free paths very quickly so that our collision avoidance algorithm can be run at high rates even on low-power computers, such as those found on board quadcopters. I will primarily be discussing the computationally efficient collision checking algorithm we developed, which is the highlight of this work. And I'll explain more in the presentation, but essentially, this consists of approximating the free space of the environment using rectangular pyramids and then using some favorable properties of the trajectory and those pyramids to perform very fast collision checking. If there's one thing to remember from this presentation, it's this idea of splitting your environment into these much simpler geometric representations in order to do rapid collision checking. Before we get too much into the details, I'm going to give a quick high-level overview of how our planner fits into the entire system architecture. So typically, for a quadcopter, we have this very fast, low-level control loop where we're taking measurements from, for example, an IMU, which are accelerometer and rate gyro, and using those to do, for example, attitude control or thrust control. Then on top of that, we have a slightly slower but still fast running control loop that takes some sensor measurements of the environment, say with a LiDAR or in this case a depth camera, turns those into some low-level representation that could be either a local map or just the depth image itself, and then uses that with some sort of planner to plan trajectories that won't collide with obstacles over the next few seconds. Those commands are then passed to the low-level controller, which actually moves the vehicle along those trajectories. Then, at the highest level, we have a more global planner. This could be, for example, a human giving waypoints to the vehicle, or perhaps an exploration-based planner that needs more time to compute where the vehicle needs to go at a high level. In this work, we're going to focus just on this middle layer. Specifically, we're only considering vehicles that have an onboard depth camera, and we're going to use a single depth image in order to plan trajectories in a receding horizon fashion that avoid obstacles over the next few seconds. So the idea is that the higher level planner will give us some high level goal to work towards. Our planner, the RAPPIDS algorithm, will then use a single depth image to find these collision-free trajectories that move us towards that high level goal. And then the low level controller will actually track those trajectories as we update them with our planner. In this work, we use a sampling-based planner in order to generate the trajectories for tracking. The way we do that is we generate a large number of candidate trajectories, evaluate each one of them with some cost function as defined by the higher level planner, check each one for collisions with the environment, throwing away those that do collide with the environment, and then repeat this process until we find, in some sense, the best trajectory from those candidate trajectories. Here we choose to specifically focus on the collision checking step of this process because that's typically the most computationally expensive step. We choose to define our candidate trajectories as fifth order polynomials in time, denoted x of t, where c5 through c0 are just three-dimensional constants defined by the initial position, velocity, and acceleration of the vehicle, as well as the position, velocity, and acceleration of the vehicle at the end of the trajectory, which we denote by time capital T. One of the main reasons that we use these fifth order polynomials as our trajectory representation is due to the dynamics of a quadcopter. Specifically, for a quadcopter which has control inputs of thrust and angular velocity, these trajectories are always guaranteed to be kinematically feasible. Secondly, this polynomial representation makes it very efficient to perform collision checking. Specifically, if we know one intersection point of our trajectory with the plane, let's say the initial position of the trajectory, we can find all other intersections with the plane by simply solving a fourth order polynomial, which we can do in closed form. Now that we've defined a representation for our trajectories, let's look at how we can check a single trajectory for collisions with the environment using the rectangular pyramids I mentioned before. We're only going to be considering checking trajectories for collisions using a single depth image, so here we're representing a side view of a depth image where the camera is on the left looking to the right. The light gray area is free space, dark gray area is obstacle space, and the interface between the two is defined by each depth pixel in the generated depth image. We're additionally going to consider areas just outside the field of view of the camera as unknown space, which we're going to constrain the vehicle to not fly through. We're also going to define a sphere around the vehicle with some radius r, which when swept along the trajectory should not collide with obstacles or the unknown space. As I mentioned before, our sampling-based planner is going to give us a single trajectory to check for collisions. And then from that trajectory, we will generate a pyramid, here denoted in green as P1, such that as long as the trajectory stays inside the pyramid, we can guarantee that the sphere containing the vehicle remains in the free space. There are more details on how to generate these pyramids in our paper and in our code online, but the general idea is that we take the endpoint of the trajectory and do a spiral search about the corresponding pixel in the depth image in order to find the largest possible pyramid that contains the endpoint of the trajectory. Finally, because we're using this fifth-order polynomial representation of the trajectory, we can find where the trajectory intersects a lateral face of the pyramid in closed form. Thus, we can separate the trajectory into a segment that remains inside the pyramid, that's the black part, and another segment that goes outside the pyramid, that's the gray part, which we would then need to further check for collisions. So now we can repeat the pyramid generation process for any segments of the trajectory that lie outside our previously generated pyramids. In this case, since our remaining trajectory segment doesn't intersect with any of the lateral faces of the second pyramid, we can label this trajectory as collision-free and continue to generate additional trajectories with our sampling-based planner. Although in this example we're showing a trajectory that's not in collision with the environment, we find trajectories as being in collision with the environment if we're unable to generate a pyramid that contains some section of that trajectory. So, for example, if our trajectory had an endpoint that lied in the obstacle space of the image, when we try to generate a pyramid, we would be unable to do so and would declare that entire trajectory as being in collision with the environment. There are many reasons that we want to use these rectangular pyramids for collision checking. Firstly, we can generate them on an as-needed basis. This means that as we go, we can generate pyramids when we need them and then reuse those for future collision checks. So for example, if we're flying down a hallway that's very simple, perhaps we only need to generate one or two pyramids and then we can use those for all of our collision checking from in that same depth image. Furthermore, because we're using this memoryless style of planning, we don't have to spend time incorporating our depth image into a global map or some more complex data structure. We can just immediately start checking trajectories for collisions with the most recently received depth image. Another really important reason for using rectangular pyramids is that we're able to implicitly avoid occluded obstacles. Specifically, because we're only approximating the space between the camera and the depth pixels, we're automatically able to avoid any obstacles that we can't see. This is contrasted with other methods that consider each pixel in the depth image as an individual obstacle, which isn't able to properly account for obstacles that might not be seen by the camera. Also, we're able to exploit the structure of the depth image when creating these pyramids because each row of pixels from left to right and top to bottom is a different angular displacement from its neighboring row. And we're also able to very easily reject trajectories that are in collision with the environment. So as I mentioned before, an example of this is if I have a trajectory that tries to go through a wall, the first thing I'm going to do is look at the endpoint of that trajectory, see that the depth pixel corresponding to that endpoint is at a depth that's closer than the endpoint, and immediately reject that trajectory without having to read any of the other pixels in the depth image. In order to compare our collision checking method to some existing collision checking methods, we created a Monte Carlo simulation in which we generated some random synthetic obstacles in a scene, generated a synthetic depth image from that, and then timed how long it took on average to check a series of candidate trajectories for collisions with those synthetically generated obstacles. Here we're comparing against two other methods, which are the first two lines in this table, both of which are KD tree-based methods. Basically, that means they treat each pixel in the depth image as an individual obstacle and then organize those into a special data structure called the KD tree that allows for a very fast computation of the minimum distance between any given sample point in 3D and the nearest obstacle, i.e. one of the pixels in the depth image. In order to keep things somewhat fair, here we're reporting the fastest collision checking times that these other two papers had reported and comparing against the average collision checking time that we saw in our Monte Carlo trials. The bottom three rows show the performance of our algorithm across three different platforms, the first being a laptop i7 processor, the second one being a Jetson TX2, and then the third an Odroid XU4, which is very similar to a Raspberry Pi if you've not heard of it. So just to reiterate, the main idea here is that if we can check our candidate trajectories for collisions much quicker than we could before, then we can generate more candidate trajectories using our sampling-based planner and check more of them for collisions, meaning that we're more likely to find a better trajectory to track from that given depth image. So hopefully I've convinced you that this collision checking method is fast, but the real question is, does it work in real life? And so we developed this experimental platform to show that. Here we're using a D435i depth camera to capture depth images, a T265 tracking camera to give us pose estimates for our planner, and then we're doing all computation on board an Odroid XU4. Before I get to the experimental results themselves, I'm going to give some quick details about the planner. Specifically, our sampling-based planner only generates candidate trajectories that bring the vehicle to rest. The idea here is that if in a given depth image we cannot find any collision-free trajectories, then we can continue to track a previously found collision-free trajectory until it brings our vehicle to rest in a location that will not collide with obstacles. We're going to evaluate each candidate trajectory using the cost function you see below. Specifically, we want to move the vehicle as fast as possible in some exploration direction denoted by D. So here we're taking the dot product of D with our initial position minus our final position and dividing by the entire duration of the trajectory. The vehicle was flown fully autonomously in a cluttered tunnel environment. Here we're capturing depth images at 30 Hz and running our planner for 30 milliseconds in a single thread when each new depth image is captured. So in this case, the planner is provided only with a desired exploration direction and then chooses the collision-free trajectory that will produce the fastest motion in that direction, as I mentioned before. When the vehicle comes to rest and is unable to find any collision-free trajectories, the exploration direction is simply rotated by 90 degrees. In the second hallway, the vehicle avoids obstacles hanging both from the ceiling as well as several obstacles leaning against the walls. Here, each hallway is roughly 20 meters long and 2.5 meters in width and height. Here we see some onboard video from the same flight. On the left, we see video recorded by a color camera. On the top right, we're showing depth images captured by the depth camera that we send to our planner. And on the bottom right, we see a point cloud visualization of the depth image combined with a rendering of the generated pyramids and the trajectory the vehicle is currently tracking. For each 30 millisecond planning stage where a collision-free trajectory was found, about 2,000 candidate trajectories and three pyramids were generated on average. The planner was able to find at least one collision-free trajectory in 35% of the depth images captured. The vehicle traveled roughly 30 meters in 43 seconds, attaining a maximum speed of 2.6 meters per second. Note that although a simple heuristic here is used to determine the exploration direction, in practice, a high-level global planner can be used to guide the vehicle, while our planner provides a guarantee that the vehicle will not collide with obstacles. In conclusion, one of the main benefits of this planner and collision checking method is that we can run it on very low power hardware, even at high rates. To our knowledge, running a planner at this rate on this level of hardware, specifically the Odroid XU4 or equivalent, hasn't been done previously to this point. Additionally, we can show that the trajectories planned by our algorithm will not collide even with occluded obstacles, which previously hasn't been investigated too thoroughly. And then we can also incorporate field of view constraints very easily. Some of the main drawbacks of using this method include the fact that it is a memoryless method. This means that we're only using a single depth image to plan each time step. Therefore, we can only plan trajectories that are inside the camera's field of view. In contrast, if we were using, say, a map-based method, we might be able to find even more collision-free trajectories that could be better than what we would find with this method. Additionally, this is only a local planning method. That means we still require the intervention of some higher-level planner. Again, that can be either a human operator or some slower-running exploration-based planner, for example. And finally, this method we found to be slightly susceptible to noise in the depth image. As I mentioned in our experimental results, we only found a collision-free trajectory in about 30% of the received depth images. In the other 70% where we didn't find any collision-free trajectories, typically what we found to be happening is that a very small amount of noise would be in the image, making it appear as if a very small obstacle was very close to the camera, invalidating the trajectories in the image. Of course, this can be fixed in future work using, for example, some filtering. But for now, that can be a concern. Finally, the code we used in these experiments can be found online at the link you see below. And with that, thank you for listening to this presentation.